Hi, good afternoon. Thanks for coming. I mean, this is the first event on our Spotlight series, sponsored by Georgetown Americas Institute. And we are, I mean, very fortunate to have with us Paula Caballero, who's the person responsible at the Nature Conservancy to deal with the Americas. Paula is the Regional Managing Director for Latin America of the Nature Conservancy. In this role, she leads a team of more than 300 staff across 16 countries, stretching from Mexico to Argentina, to deliver bold new strategies and partnerships to conserve the world's most biodiverse region. She has extensive experience in sustainable development. She is recognized as having created the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And I urge you to go, and Paula will tell us the title of the book, but she wrote a great book with her co-author and partner in basically developing the SDGs on how they negotiated the world diplomacy to actually make this a reality. And that was another topic that we wanted her to touch in this talk, but she's going to focus on the Nature Conservancy work. But I urge you to read that book. It's a marvelous book. So she's recognized as having created the UN Sustainable Development Goals concept, which is considered to be a blueprint to achieve a better and more sustainable future for all. For this work, she received the German Sustainability Award in 2019 and the Sayed International Prize for the Environment in 2014 for her contribution to environmental action leading to positive change. So with that, I leave the floor for Paula. She will give us a presentation, and then we will have some space for a Q&A session.
Muchas gracias. Thank you very much, Alejandro, for inviting me, and thank you all for making the time to join me today. So Alejandro spoke briefly about TNC. Let me just tell you a little bit more, because I'll be referencing our work so you know a little bit more about what we're about. So TNC, as we call it, is one of the world's largest so-called environmental organizations. Although I would hasten to add that I do not think we're about conservation, we're about sustainable development. We are deeply science-based, and I joined TNC after working in many places because I think that TNC has a really unique capacity to bridge and to work with a very wide range of stakeholders. And given the immensity of the challenges and the crisis that we're facing, we really do need to think big. This is what I want to talk to you about. As Alejandro said, I have a track record in this arena. When I left the Colombian government after that creation process of the SDGs, and the book that we wrote is called Redefining Development, The Extraordinary Genesis of the SDGs. And the reason we wrote it is because we wanted people to understand how challenging, no, that's wrong, how incredibly impossible it was to create and to get a negotiation, to get agreement on a wild concept called the SDGs, when everybody had a nice, tidy little package of very minimalist objectives called the Millennium Development Goals. And understanding the fight and the struggle that it took to really lead a paradigm shift, and it wasn't Colombia only, we created what I used to call the secret friends of the SDGs, working behind the scenes to make this possible. That's where you understand where we are today, and that you can't just implement the SDGs or achieve the Paris Agreement by doing more of the same. And that's really what I want to focus the conversation on. It's not just a question of resources. When I was Senior Director of Environment at the World Bank, I created the Global Practice for Environment. My budget, my working budget, was $7.2 billion. And I felt that that was absolutely insufficient for what we needed to do. So Jen Morris, who leads TNC, talks about radical collaboration, and that's really what I want to leave. One of the many deep messages I want to leave with all of you is that it is really and truly about radical collaboration. So we are looking at a world that is in incredible flux, and it seems to be speeding up, right, all the time. It's the technology. It's the movements of people, movements of information, developments with AI, et cetera. And for that, we need very ambitious and systemic responses. And I particularly think that Latin America has a very particular role to play in that. I've been talking too much today. Why Latin America? Latin America has about 1/4 of the world's remaining forests, over 1/3 of its fresh water, and almost half of its species. But here's what's really amazing about Latin America. It is an entire continent, an entire hemisphere, that shares one language and one culture. And largely, with the exception of Belize and Suriname and Guyana, one legal system. And to those who talk about Latin America and Brazil, I say no. Brazil is inherently and absolutely part of Latin America. We all speak Portuñol. We can all understand each other. There is no other place in the world that has that capacity for scale and for replication and for multiplication. So Latin America is uniquely positioned to lead change, to show change in this world. I do not think it is a coincidence that it was the SDGs that came as a Latin American proposal, because it wasn't just Colombia. At the end of the day, read the book, in the last-ditch horrible negotiations in Rio, Brazil made difficult choices, and they chose the most ambitious outcome possible. So my key message is that business as usual won't cut it. I tell my team, which is actually closer to 500 people right now, that if they wake up in the morning really happy and feeling like we're doing a good job, they need to have a strong coffee and rethink. Every day we have to go wake up thinking, what do we need to do differently? How can we push ourselves? And that is absolutely imperative. Because otherwise, we trick ourselves into thinking that we're doing things differently, and we're part of the problem. We're just doing the more projects, more proposals, more programs that fit into that exact same paradigm that supposedly we're trying to change. So we need to not just look at root causes, which is important, but we need to understand how they interact and how those root causes generate trade-offs across time spans, across sectors, across stakeholders. To me, the definition of sustainability is really simple. It is, and I don't want to sound like I'm monetizing everything, but it's a language that works. We have natural, environmental or natural, economic and social capital. And what you need to do is find solutions that grow the three capitals, or at a minimum, do not grow one at the expense of the other. That's the formula. That's how simple it is. But you cannot do that through business as usual, because business as usual is why we end up where we end up right now. So what does this look like? At TNC, we have spent many years looking at how we engineer, and I use that word very consciously, engineer durable shifts for sustainable development pathways. And I want to say that what is really critical, because yes, we work on conservation, and yes, we work on regenerative agriculture, is that we have a really clear focus on the levers of change, on policy, on markets, on finance, on mindsets and behavior. And those are critical, because until we change those and really engineer systems change, we're just tweaking business as usual, the establishment, the inertia, the status quo. And so that means that we can only be successful if we work at a systems level. And that means working with stakeholders, understanding and co-creating solutions. It's time-consuming, but it's necessary. Working with governments at all levels to change policy, and I'll give you some good examples of what that looks like. Transforming markets and value chains, entire value chains. You can't just work with a couple of producers or do demo farms and say, oh, yay, we have 200 producers that have shifted to sustainable practices. That's nice. That's not a tipping point. That's not going to really change matters. We have to support indigenous peoples. Across Latin America, more or less 30% of the remaining forests and pristine lands that we need to salvage and safeguard and protect are indigenous lands. And they're under threat as no other time. So we need to help them find voice. We need to help them manage their own resources. And we need to help them have agency to protect their territories. Note, please, that I never use the word we empower indigenous peoples. There's no power for us to give. Even that mindset is part of the business as usual. That's how hard it is. Every day grabbing ourselves and putting the mirror up and saying, how are we replicating the same mindsets, the same approaches that got us into the situation? And we have to develop innovative finance mechanisms, something that TNC is very good at and that I will allude to also here, because we need to blend different sources of finance for that transformative change. And if we can harness all of these forces, all of these levers, and do that radical collaboration, then we're starting to get on a pathway of change at the scale that is needed. So let me talk about some of the really important work that needs to be done. We all know Paris 1.5, and it's a closing window to really deliver on runaway climate change. And what we know is that humanity will not be able to deliver that 1.5 target without nature. We have done some deep science and deep research, and about one third of what is needed to get us to Paris are what is called natural climate solutions. Natural climate solutions, or NCS, are very simple. And I would add to all of you who are scientists here that it is the only technology that is really proven and tested and cost efficient. It's very simple. It's about protecting forests, protecting wetlands and mangroves. It's about restoration. It is critically about working with agriculture and ranching and helping them shift to more sustainable practices, not because it's good for the planet, but because it's good for them and the planet, because it increases yields and productivity and the amount of the number of head of cattle that you can put in a hectare. Then you're talking, because you're finding win-win solutions that don't have those trade-offs between the capital. And so the great thing about nature-based solutions or natural climate solution, NCS, is that they create enormous co-benefits. So you have a situation where you're sequestering the carbon, but you're improving productivity, you're including resilience, you're probably reducing exposure to risk, to floods or to fire. And when you start to calculate and build in what all of that means in monetary terms, the return on investment is unequaled and unparalleled. But our mindset is that we do not value that standing forest, and we have a very hard time valuing and understanding, monetizing what nature is providing. The other piece is that at TNC, we're not just practicing, we're not just preaching, we practice. We have our own very ambitious targets. I purposely took out that slide because I said, you're not interested in what TNC does, but in what TNC does that can be of use to you. Let me just give you one of the goals. We have an aim to sequester 3 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide equivalent every year. That's like taking 650 million cars off the road every year. That's what TNC is aiming to do through the work. And we have equally ambitious goals on fresh water, on people, on lands. So the potential of nature-based solutions or natural climate solutions is enormous, but it's great untapped potential, and especially for Latin America. So let me tell you why Latin America is really at the epicenter of this. Why all of us who work in Latin America have such a unique opportunity. Latin America has a unique role in safeguarding our global climate. Already 20% of global carbon offsets come from Latin America, and no other region has greater potential for delivering on this front. But we need a big shift. Currently, agriculture, forestry, and land use account for over 50% of emissions. In some countries, for example, in Colombia, it accounts for over 60% of emissions. So very clearly, the region cannot contribute to meeting that 1.5 target without radically shifting how it manages land. I would say that it's not a choice, now it's a responsibility. But we need all of us to show those sectors how to do it in a way that is not about trade-offs, that is not about just stopping eating meat or stopping producing or stopping sowing because the planet needs it. No, we have to find those win-win solutions. Let me give you some of the numbers of what this could mean. Latin America could potentially reduce 3 billion metric tons of CO2 equivalent through nature climate solutions every year. 3 billion metric tons. That's almost 50% of the greenhouse gases produced by the US in 2021. And it's equivalent to 30% of the total NCS mitigation potential in the world, 30% of that potential. But here's the thing, and this is where it gets really interesting. These shifts, to be able to generate those gains, require a significant change in the finance sector. Again, we go back to systems change. The finance sector has to provide patient capital. The finance sector has to incentivize and reward those practices. The finance sector itself has to shift to align with these kinds of metrics. And we need blended finance. We need different sources of finance. One of them that I'm going to talk about today is carbon finance. Obviously, through very high quality carbon projects that are transparent and that are equitable at their source, and managing a variety of financial instruments. If we do this, Latin America, remember I just said 3 billion tons? Well, Latin America has really the potential to unlock 5.9 billion metric tons of CO2 equivalent per year if we can unlock the finance. That's what's at stake. That's why Latin America is so absolutely fundamental to all this. And that's why TNC is working on increasing the transparency, the integrity, the fairness, the equity behind the work that we do in those carbon markets. Let me talk about another dimension, which is water and water security. I mentioned that we represent about 1/3 of the world's fresh water. It's unevenly distributed, but the potential is there. And addressing water and water sensible, integrated, sustainable water management is central to food security, water security, energy security, livelihoods. It is not an environmental issue. It is at its heart a core economic issue. And let me tell you something, because many of you I know are working on international relations or interested in the international dimension of all of this work. About 60% of our freshwater resources are transboundary. So that management of water in a place like Latin America, but as well Africa and the rest of the world, is about transboundary cooperation. So that's a dimension that many of you may want to explore. Let me give you an example so you can see what I mean. The River Basin Plate, Rio de la Plata, is the world's largest exporter of agricultural commodities. It's about 40% of agricultural commodities worldwide. But you're wrong if you think that what's flowing through there is beef and soy. It's water. Latin America is exporting water. Those are water-intensive commodities. Think of it another way. In Sao Paulo, there was a massive drought in 2014-2015. It cost more or less $500 million. It was huge economic costs and social implications. It was estimated in a very thorough study that if they had managed to integrate the watersheds around Sao Paulo that feed Sao Paulo the water with an integrated approach, the cost would have been reduced about 28%, just through better management of the watershed. Again, we go back to the policy, and what are some of those policies? In Santa Catarina State in the south of Brazil, for example, TNC, many years ago, led some of the first policies whereby the water utility was able to invest a portion of the revenue back into the watershed, doing exactly what Sao Paulo hadn't done. It's a win-win. You're actually paying for the water that nature is providing. That is not an environmental transaction. That is an economic transaction, social transaction. And so when we look at water again, it demands systemic interventions. It demands that systemic look at what we need to do. And this is where it is really fundamental that we look at those levers, the finance and the policy and the markets, to change the signals and to change the trajectories. So let me give you three examples from our work in Latin America that I hope will help bring home some of what I'm talking about today. So I'm going to take you first to Pará. It's in a state in the Amazonas Legal of Brazil. And Pará is a fairly remarkable place where we are fighting rampant deforestation. Over 20% of all deforestation in the last 30 years worldwide has happened in Pará. But it's a huge state. It's about 3 times the size of California. So 70%, and that's the good news, of the state is still covered with forest. Dealing with the deforestation drivers is not something that you can do by just working with a couple of ranchers and trying to stop drivers of deforestation. You need an integrated solution. So we're working with cattle ranchers, big and small. We are working with changing the beef industry by having ensuring traceability throughout the whole supply chain so that the slaughterhouses can only buy cattle that are certified to have been not just born but raised, because cattle go through many farms usually, and never had any deforestation footprint. People have said it's impossible. We're working on it. We're working with indigenous peoples, helping them create their first funds, Podali Fund, that they manage, they organize. We work with smallholders, generating, for example, with it's in this picture, Cacao Foresta, 10-year program, helping them shift to agroforestry processes that include cacao and a combination of crops so that they have greater livelihood security. And we are partnering also with the state governor. He is ambitious. He's unrolling a series of very transformational work, digital platform, multi-stakeholder platform policies, and TNC has been supporting the state government through all of this. Let me focus on one area, bioeconomy. Sure, you'll hear about it. We like to speak of social bioeconomy. It's getting more and more traction. It's at the G20 next year. That's when it's going to be Brazil's, one of Brazil's big places, bioeconomy. Well, we worked in Pará. First, we did a study together with IDB and Natura, where we were able to show that with changing the right production infrastructure and the local value addition and the global market access, we could transform the economic production in Pará state through a suite of about 30 products that includes things like cashew nuts and acai and Brazil nuts. And this could, over time, generate over $3 billion by 2040 or 2050. So we're showing and putting in place the studies to demonstrate how bioeconomy could unfold. And now we worked with the state of Pará to develop the very first bioeconomy policy in the world. And we're now working with the federal government to do that at a federal level. We are also going to be working with other states that also want to develop this kind of a policy. So again, a systemic approach that's looking at how you build in and how you work with the different stakeholders, the different levers, the different value chains to be able to really create a very, very different economic reality. That's a blueprint for change. Now let me take you somewhere else in Latin America, to Belize. The Selva Maya, which is shared with Mexico and Guatemala, is actually pretty important. It is the second largest tropical rainforest in Latin America. Over about 20 years to 2018, Belize had deforested almost a quarter of its forests. At that point, TNC, with very key partners, was able to go in and we acquired almost 100,000 acres. And these acres prevented the conversion of that land. You're seeing the photo here of this land into agricultural land. We now, together with other work and other acquisitions that have been done, are safeguarding about 10% of Belize's forests, working with communities. This is not conservation to keep people out. This is conservation to work with people to safeguard the very precious water resources. And we have used the first set of acquisitions for very innovative carbon projects that certified offsets worth about $1.5 million, a lot of which has been plowed back into better management of this. And now we are working on a new deal with the Belize Maya Forest, creating a very large carbon project with the government. And the agreement with the government is that the carbon credit sales from this will cover half the costs of the acquisition of the land, and will establish a $15 million endowment to manage this land in perpetuity. And the $15 million is being managed by a new trust with local stewards called the Belize Maya Forest Trust. So this is, again, a win-win, and thinking at scale and thinking big. I've talked about place-based. Let me now talk about sectors. I've mentioned agriculture and ranching. And I want to say that this is an absolutely critical way to engender that systems change as I said earlier, shifting and changing entire value chains. So ranching, if just think of this, if cows were a country, ranching land used for ranching were a country, it would occupy almost 37% of Latin America. I simply call it the omnipresent cow. And that is not going to change. So we have to work with big and small landowners to better manage ranching practices. And we're doing it. And it changes. In some places, clearing forests for putting in cows is not a good thing. But in certain grasslands, sustainable management through integrated silvopastoral systems is a really good thing. So you need to have very localized, very specific solutions. And the fact is that unless we change conventional food production, and in Latin America, remember I said that we are exporting through Rio de la Plata about 40% of agricultural commodities, that demand, right now Latin America supplies the world about 25% of agricultural, including fisheries production. That number is going to grow. The intensity of the demands in our agriculture, or sector agropecuario to be more precise, is going to increase. So shifting this is absolutely fundamental and time sensitive. So we're engineering entire value chains so that we can change the systems and generate benefits for soil health, also carbon, for biodiversity, increase productivity, resilience against climate threats, improved livelihoods, and economic diversification. It's a win-win. But we work in solutions co-created with stakeholders. There's nothing about imposing solutions, because that doesn't work. One big project that we have across five countries, which we call Future Landscapes, is going to transform 3 million hectares into regenerative landscapes. It is cutting GHG emissions by 25%, and it's benefiting 22,000 people. So that's also what actual change looks like. So as you can see, I think that Latin America has really very rare opportunity to step up to these changes and to stop seeing the environment dimension, and it is a dimension, as something other, something optional, something that is in the way of development. The huge potential for Latin America is to create sustainable, equitable growth, because this is also where we deal with our horrible Gini across the region, in ways that generate that win-win. And you know, we often say that we have until 2030 or until 2050. I've told my team that the word until is prescribed. It's not until, it's now. Because think of the complexity of everything we've been talking about. Engineering those solutions, engineering those pathways is going to take time. So it's now. Now you're still studying. Start thinking about what your now looks like and what you can do, and start to engineer now, so that the pathway starts to change, so the trajectory starts to change. This for me is sort of my guiding light. It's this idea that we don't have to do what is possible. We have to do what is necessary. And that's different. And if I can go back to my story of the SDGs, when we proposed the SDGs, we were told, huh, what do you mean? A whole complexity of development? You want an integrated metric? And what, developed countries don't have problems. They've sorted out all their development problems. You want a universal integrated metric that includes all of the complexity of development? You are completely mad. And yet that was exactly what we needed, right? So focus on that. Not what is needed, not what is simple, not what is possible, not what is within reach, but what seems impossible. Because otherwise we are part of that business as usual, and we're part of perpetuating the comfort zone that is exactly taking us in the trajectories and the trends that we are seeing today. So 2030 is now is really our mantra in Latin America for TNC. We've made t-shirts with that, and I really want to invite you to embrace that, because if we are going to keep to 1.5 degrees, if we are going to capitalize on these incredible wealth and riches and potential that Latin America has, we have to change the mindsets, we have to change the finance, we have to change the policy, we have to change the incentives and the rewards and markets now. And it can't be done alone, but the great thing is, as I said at the beginning, we are one single, unique hemisphere. with one language and one culture. So the opportunities are legion, and the opportunities for all of you as you think of what you go forward are legion. But think ambitiously, really ambitious, and think out of the box. And then you will make the impossible happen. Thank you.
Very much. I think it was an extremely enlightening presentation. Also a little bit humbling, given the task that, I mean, the world has in front of them and the task that obviously you and your teams, but a lot of people focusing on these issues are confronting. I think, I mean, you touch among so many things, and I don't fully know exactly what's our common level of understanding of the things that you mentioned. So maybe I will ask you a couple of clarifying things so that, I mean the students might, those of you that have not gotten into the nitty gritty of these topics, clarify some things, and then we open it up to questions. So a couple of things, you say we need financing, we need long-term financing, and we need blended finance. No, so the concept of blended finance, that is one. Then, I mean, you talked a lot about patient finance, but then on your description of some of the projects, you focus much more on the complexities on coordinating several stakeholders, you know, policymakers, ranchers, indigenous communities. So maybe it's the mix. I mean, you could think of, if you had all these things integrated with one big firm, maybe they will coordinate and they will get the financing, or they might get the financing. You can go out in the market and place a perpetual bond that never matures, that never expires. Those things exist and big companies can get it. But when you have, I mean, indigenous communities that own the space, or when you have some firms that are operating there, the property rights are not well defined. So exactly where's the cracks of the problem that really impedes this thing going, and how your work helps solve these things, and sometimes with some extra financing and generating incentives for people to coordinate, et cetera. And also, so that would be another of my question. And a third, and I guess because of its size, it's nice that you talk about Belize, but we end up talking about Brazil, and the ranchers are in Brazil. I mean, the forest is in Brazil, and the water. I mean, we have, I guess, the Iguazu Falls there, no? But how about, I mean, your work on Central America, you touch upon Belize, but Central American countries are extremely also vulnerable to natural disasters, et cetera, and to climate change, and maybe the Caribbean as well. How that your work on that part of the region is doing, and maybe quickly we go through some of those things and then we open it up to questions.
Thank you very much, Alejandro. Very good questions. This is all very complex. And the simple answer is that there is no simple answer. There's no single right approach. So start with the finance. Basically, what we need is to shift capital, not only so that it goes to support things like, for example, moving a farm, a cattle ranching farm, a ranch, from unsustainable to sustainable practices, for example, silvopastoral approaches, or approaches that enable intensification of the herd, needs upfront investment. And that upfront investment is oftentimes very, very difficult for a producer to access for many reasons. Land tenure, you mentioned, land tenure is across Latin America, a huge issue. They don't have enough credit and they don't have enough collateral to be able to access the financing that's needed. And many times it's perceived as very risky by the finance sector, by your local banker, so they're not also going to provide that kind of credit. But unless you're able to get that upfront financing, you can't transform your farm. And so the conundrum there can be solved if we do training and if we work with all of the different stakeholders. so that you understand, that's what I mean by patient capital. You work with the finance sector so they can open rural credit lines and work to identify ways of de-risking, and that's where blending comes in. If you have philanthropic capital or grants, you can use that to de-risk the operation for the banking sector, for the finance sector. Because what it's the thing is about a lot of these transitions, and it's not just in the land use sector for energy, for example, or if you're going to transform even transport in a city, there's going to be enormous benefits that pay off over time, but you need an upfront investment. And oftentimes that upfront capital is very difficult to access. So that's one part, and then you can blend the capital. For example, restoration, simply doing carbon projects. By carbon projects, I mean projects where you can monetize the carbon that is not going to be emitted or the carbon that's going to be sequestered, and you can get carbon credits for that. It's more complicated than that, but to keep it simple. And those carbon credits can generate, can be sold on the voluntary or the compliance market, and you have actual cash. But that's insufficient to finance, for example, restoration of a large swath of land. So you need to bring in additional forms of capital to be able to finance that. Over time, it is a win-win, because you are, above all, and starting with, contributing to mitigation, to a global public good. But you are also, if managed right, generating longer-term financial flows for the farmer. But you need to blend the different kinds and the different sources of capital so that together they add up to be able to compensate the costs and cover the costs and the return on investment for that farmer. So we've been doing a lot of work in that. And something else that we have also done, which is very interesting that I didn't mention here, which is that we're also working at a sovereign level. So in Belize, for example, we also did a debt for nature swap with Belize, which has generated, reduced Belize's foreign sovereign debt by about $180 million. And part of the savings are being channeled back into marine protection. So Belize has committed to protecting 30% of its marine areas. So that's another source of finance. So that's what I mean with blended finance. There's different definitions. I mean it here in the simplest way, just that you need to be creative, we need to be innovative, and we need to generate many different kinds and sources of capital flows and of finance flows to be able to finance this transition and to convince the finance sector and others that this is actually good for business. So I can give you another example. In the Cerrado, we're working on a great project called Reverte. And the idea there is that soy production needs to increase, but you don't have to deforest. You can do it on degraded land. So we are working with Syngenta, and we are working with Itaú and Santander banks to be able to generate the funding and the technical assistance and the support so that this degraded land can be used for expanding soy production. So again, it takes a lot of stakeholders. So yes, it takes all of these examples that I'm giving are about a lot of stakeholders, but it's going to be at different levels, and you're going to need, even in a single value chain or a single geography, to bring together different coalitions of stakeholders, because the problems are really, really complex. But we need that kind of ambition. And lastly, on the Central America, I just have to say that in Latin Central America, currently we only work in Belize and Guatemala. We're not working in the other areas. And we have a very vibrant Caribbean program, but I don't run that.
So let's open it up to questions, please. I mean, just identify yourself, tell us which program you're in, and then your question.
I'm Edith. I'm an alum from the Sustainability Management Program. And as a recent grad, it's been tough, a lot of rejections. It's not been easy, but it's also given me a lot of time to reflect on my career goals. And I just wanted to know, when you were 23, in your 20s, how did you navigate your career goals? And if you could give me any insights about that.
Let's take 2-3 questions, and then you go over.
Okay.
Them. Yep. No.
Hi, I'm Melanie. I don't go here. but hello. Thank you for having it open to the public, because this was amazing. I had a question on what you think the impact of increased demand in minerals and mining will have on this effort to conserve land, water, and make the agriculture sector more resilient.
Hi, my name is Maria. I'm an undergrad student in the SFS. I was just wondering, obviously in a lot of like these Latin American countries, there is a really big political elite that doesn't want these changes to happen, that own a lot of land. So how are you able to like have these conversations about policies and kind of get around these political blockades to these kind of initiatives?
Hi, I'm in the Masters of International Development Policy, and I wanted to ask how the TNC approaches all of the social implications that come with working with vulnerable populations that are in conflict, such as like the ranchers in Pará taking land from indigenous people, yet both of those populations need to be integrated in the solution.
Question. So I have experience in property management, and I encountered a very many related challenges to like land use and maintenance and stakeholder engagements. And I was just wondering how TNC navigates similar challenges when managing large conservation areas in LAC and the LAC region, especially when balancing like ecological protection and local community needs. Just kind of around her question as well.
I'm in the Latin American Studies program minor thesis, and so I just wanted to know in terms of the NatureLink debt swapping, in terms of how you're running that. I know the program you mentioned with Belize, how are you monitoring that after the initial creation of the program, and how is it managing the expectations of Belize's government and then other governments that actually have offered that debt reduction, sort of understanding how to really monitor the success of the environmental programs with obviously the economic implications of that too.
These are all really, really good questions. So I'm not really sure where to start. Maybe I'll just try to take them in order. So career goals, I've just been obsessed all my life with environment, and I understood always that environment is not a thing. There's no such thing as environment. When I was global director of environment at the World Bank, I would sit with ministers of finance and say to them, let's talk real stuff. I don't really care about environment. And we would talk about environment, but with a socioeconomic lens. And I grew that program 215% in the 2 years I was at the bank. So that has always been my driver and my understanding of how you position that so that you can it can translate and make sense to people. And that's really that understanding and that obsession, because I think I'm really driven by the need to bring about some kind of change in whatever sphere of influence I have. I think that oriented, and that has always oriented my career decisions. I've had a very varied career, but I never stuck to anything. I just was always trying to see where can I have the biggest impact. And now I found TNC, and so I think I'm gonna stay there forever. I really like it, but that was my career goal. Mining is a huge issue, and it's gonna grow. I mean, we're already looking at the devastation of so-called illegal mining, and there's nothing very illegal. I mean, it is illegal, but you have this idea of a couple of poor people sort of, you know, with pans on. These are multi-million dollar investment with dredges and the levels of also of corruption that are involved around a lot of the mining, the informal or illegal mining is pretty serious. And you have also organized crime. And I'm always saying, lately I keep saying, organized crime, why don't we have like organized sustainability? What's wrong with us? But there is a lot of very big organized crime moving into places around that. And obviously the minerals that the green transition are gonna demand, lithium and cobalt and all of that, are already creating huge, huge challenges. And I'll be very honest, I'm struggling with that at TNC because in some cases it's almost you need a state reaction, a state response. And what an NGO can do, even a big NGO, muscular, agile, that partners with everybody. So we're partnering and looking at how we can find entryways or pathways where our value add makes sense. But this is really where we're going to need radical collaboration big time. And it's an issue that is only going to grow. I mean, you've already, for example, lithium, we're already seeing the challenges that that's bringing in the salt plains of Bolivia, Argentina, et cetera. So a huge question that we all have to pay a lot of attention to. I was asked about the polarization, and part of the polarization is addressing it. It's not coming at it by saying this is an environment conservation agenda and we're trying to keep people out, or we're trying, you know, don't eat meat. We have to find ways of communicating and talking and translating this agenda so that it makes sense. So when, for example, we talk about the beef value chain, we're working with the beef, not against them, with them, so that we can bring about change within the value chain at a level that it starts to be make sense and make a business sense. Because if you put in real traceability mechanisms, for example, it becomes harder and harder for producers not to be a part of a sustainable what we call zero conversion, because it's not just deforestation, it's also grasslands, et cetera, zero conversion commodities. So we need to be able to translate in language that makes sense. And that's absolutely important. And so when we are having conversations about water, for example, when I said what you're exporting is not beef or soy, you're exporting water, that's a really simple way of talking to maybe a policymaker or a decision maker that thinks that these are all very woke agendas and that it's all ridiculous. But helping translate and having, and the SDGs also help because it's a universal agenda. But you need to do that. And in Pará, we've been working for over 10 years. And there's, you know, the current governor, for example, was reelected. And he has a very strong sustainability agenda. But there's many in Pará and in other states that are not subscribing to this agenda. So we have to understand and help translate, make the business case for why this makes sense from a productivity and from a market access, long-term market access perspective. Regarding indigenous vulnerable communities, TNC has something called VCA, Voice Choice Action. I invite you to, we have a lot of information in our website about that. And VCA is really about that, about giving voice, giving agency, and working with local producers, with vulnerable communities. And it's one of the reasons I joined TNC, because this isn't about ticking the box, and it's not about, for example, all these panels, they bring in one indigenous person so that they can showcase inclusion and all these awful practices. TNC really works with these people. I have been in meetings with indigenous leaders who say, with very moving language, that TNC is the only organization that has been their partner and supported them over 20 years. And I can say I'm proud of that, because I haven't been part of TNC 20 years. I joined just a year and a half ago. But that's what voice choice in action means and translates into. We also have very rigorous safeguards. We work on that, and we provide support to partners also to make sure that safeguards are, and that the right kind of approach is put in place. As I said, for example, many can talk about empowering communities. That's the wrong kind of language. That's even the mindset that you have power to give. And you have to even look there, hold up the mirror to yourselves, and understand that when you say that, you're already there being a part of the problem. Because it's about recognizing agency is very different than empowering. So I think we have a very powerful track record in TNC on that. Somebody said what an example, or how we actually, when we're managing large lands, how that works so it's not against communities. A very good example is Reserva Valdiviana in the Pacific coast of Chile, of course, midway down the coast of Chile in the Valdivian area. This is about almost 96, almost 19-odd thousand hectares. It's a very large reserve that was purchased, that was going to be logged, and it was purchased. It's pristine forest. I get goose pimples when I remember it. Has alerces, which are like the redwoods of the south. You have to see these trees and these forests. And there we work with communities, and because we preserve this land, the fishing also has not been affected as in other places, because there's no runoff. So there's pristine fisheries, And so we work and have been working also with a very strong gender lens with these coastal communities for many years. And they are the park rangers. They benefit from the preservation of the land, and we work with them. Belize. So part of the agreement with the Belize government was to create a marine protected spatial plan. And so that is being developed by the team, and that will help orient integrated coastal zone and marine planning. And it has very clear metrics and very clear pathways. So that's a part of the answer. I don't want to speak so long because I'm sure that there might be other comments or questions.
Questions?
So that was great. And I was wondering what the role is for consumer markets, because listening to you, you have a problem of finance. There's a political problem as well in Latin America. But it seems to me, listening to you, that one of the major problems is that the consumer markets need to lay down the law. That's highly problematic, though. We know that when the Europeans imposed sanctions on soya from the Amazon, producers simply changed their production to the Cerrado and started deforesting the Cerrado to produce the soya to sell to the European market. And it's really difficult to get consumer market coordination now, right? Because the United States and China are not talking to one another, and the WTO is at a terrible state, and the Europeans are doing their thing. So I was wondering, is there anything you guys are doing with consumer markets in order to produce some kind of convergence between these countries? Not the least because the one source of patient capital in Latin America is, of course, China. And that engenders its own set of problems with the United States in the region.
Hi, I'm Renee from SFS. Thank you so much for sharing. And it's amazing that you started this whole SDGs thing that is so common now. I think I wanted to ask about things related to climate finance, because I did a bit of research on it. And I know that one problem related to carbon credits is like disclosure standards and whether there's like greenwashing and whether you're able to decide like which projects are actually like offsetting carbon. So I wanted to know what are your thoughts on that and like what progress can be made in this area and what is the progress that has been happening now. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Kenny. I'm an undergraduate in the college, and thank you so much for doing this. I was also along the lines of finance. So you said that it's sort of, you need to integrate these various like stakeholders, like farmers, and also these like the finance sector. I was wondering, where do you initiate this conversation? Because I know that both the finance sector can be reluctant, as well as farmers can be also reluctant to change their practices. Who do you start with, and how have you approached this in the past? And have you, I guess, been seeing a change in the perception of the finance sector to these more sustainable practices?
Thank you very much. My name is Rodolfo. I am with the Embassy of Guatemala here in Washington, D.C. And I know the Nature Conservancy is very well established in my country and working very, you know, impactful projects. Could you elaborate on the partnerships with governments, and also if there's also spaces for the Nature Conservancy to develop collaboration opportunities in private sector, private public, I mean?
So I'm going to be innovative. I'm going to start with the last question first. Stir it up a bit. So muchísimas gracias. Yes, we're proud of the fact that we work very well and very closely with the government of Guatemala. One of the big plays we have there right now is to work in a more integrated way around the Selva Maya. For example, a lot of the deforestation is led by the cattle ranching sector, but it's illegal cattle ranching. So you need to really work across the three countries to be able to find and to put in place the right kind of solutions and the right kinds of incentives and mechanisms. So we've done a very broad analysis of market-driven forces in the, especially Petén in Guatemala, but all of the Selva Maya, and increasingly looking to work and to be able to broker. We talked about transboundary across the three countries. We also do a lot of work in the freshwater sector, and Selva Maya, all of that is a water, freshwater powerhouse. But those resources are getting depleted and contaminated, so we're doing a lot of work there. We have work in the what we call the Mesoamerican Forest Bridge from Chiapas all the way down through Guatemala, and we have very interesting work with forest concessions and other work in Petén that we're very proud of. And so I go to Guatemala a lot to look at that fantastic work, so thank you for that. Private sector, absolutely. When I talk about producers, when I talk about value chains, finance, all of that is private sector. And I've actually, I'm building out my team on corporate engagement so that we can work not just to get philanthropy from private sector, but to change business practices. So that's absolutely critical. You were asking where you start the conversation. There's not one size fits all. And many times you have to actually have very different conversations, continuous conversations, to start to make the business case, build the trust and the transparency so that you are able to broker conversations and to co-design solutions. What's really important, when I said at the beginning of working with all of these different groups, is that you don't come in with a given solution, but that you really listen and understand what the different interests are and are able to then come to find more innovative and creative solutions. Carbon markets, huge issues around integrity, transparency, and equity, and we work on that. Equity, transparency, and integrity. We're part of an international group that is working to strengthen particularly the voluntary carbon market. And so there's been a lot of articles, I'm sure you've all seen it, selling hot air, the greenwashing, and it has been a bit of a wild west. But oftentimes when you start with a new commodity, that's how it happens. And what we say is that if carbon is a new commodity, the way the commodities have been developed have left very little value in territories. And so if carbon is going, and carbon finance and carbon flows are going to help us resolve some of the problems created by these other commodities, well, we have to fix and we have to re-engineer the carbon market so that it doesn't become a part of the problem but a part of the solution. And so TNC at different levels is working on that globally and in terms of helping specific governments, Chile, Colombia, others, develop that better carbon market policies. But it's a work in progress, and it's going to take a lot of hands. So if any of you guys want to work in that space when you graduate, please, we need a lot of support for that. Consumer, absolutely. Moreover, because when we talk about these market forces and the transparency, et cetera, well, in Brazil or Colombia, 60% of meat is consumed domestically. So you can have all the market signals of zero conversion and zero deforestation coming from the EU, but that's only a tiny fraction of the market. So the question is, how can you engineer, how can you change, how can you use that pull factor from those policies that have a limited space and use that to start to create changes across the entire value chain where it actually becomes better for slaughterhouses, for example, to work entirely with full transparency and traceability across the entire value chain. But then you have to work with those that are in illegality to help them come into illegality, because otherwise you're perpetuating the same process. Again, that systems change approach. And we actually have a very strong policy team in Europe and a very strong policy team in China. So we work across all of these different markets and these different policy arenas to help align. And one of the areas that I think is very important in Latin America is a lot of times these well-intentioned, because they are trying to, you know, meet the 1.5 target or whatever, that come from Europe, land very badly in Latin America. I've worked with the Colombian government. I know how it lands. It does not land well, no matter how well-intentioned. So you really have to work with the producers and help translate those policies into win-wins. So it's not seen as an imposition, but it actually, you start to see that over the long term, the return on investment of shifting to these practices is actually good for us. And so engineering that, it's a long-term play, and you need patient everything, but resist persistence. You have to be relentless. And to your question about career, whatever you do, but be relentless. Never give up, because what we need to shift and what we need to do is really hard, and we're not going to be able to do it overnight.
An extremely stimulating talk. I guess we could stay here for another 2 hours, learning much more from the different projects you have in the region. But again, thank you for coming here, sharing with us and with the Georgetown community about your work. And we hope you come here again and we continue this conversation. Thanks, Paula.